All right, we had a request for the theme song.
We got a request, yeah.
You want to come up and sing it? All right, come on up and sing it. You guys got to help us with the intro, okay?
Yeah.
I'm gonna go 1, 2, 3. Let me go. Okay. Ready? Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Time to get restless. There's always something new. Hey, 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 for the monkey. Keep the monkey around. We're too busy singing to put anybody down. We're just trying to be friendly. Come watch, sing, and play. Cause we're the young generation and we've got something to say. Look over your shoulder. Guess who'll be standing there?
Like on the fly arrangements.
Nice job, my friend. Thank you.
What do I hear?
No, that's the wrong band. We did that one. Oh, we can do that one. Yeah. Right, a one, two. Here we go.
Clapping here. Because I got to play the tambourine, remember?
Walk out. Walk out. We got things to say. Talk out. Let's have a talk out. Things will be okay. Hey, girl.
Na, 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 na.
I don't want to fight.
Na, 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 na,
I'm a little bit wrong.
Na, 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 na.
You're a little bit right. It's true.
Na, 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 na,
it's a little bit me.
It's a little bit me.
It's a little bit you. Two.
Three.
Don't know just what I said wrong, but girl, I apologize. Don't go. Here's where you belong. So wipe the tears from your eyes. Right.
Na, 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 na,
and I say, girl,
na, na, na,
little bit to you. Two. It's a little bit me.
Oh, wait, no, that was the withdrawing version.
You
want BW Washburn. Well, hold on. We're going to give you guys, just real quick, original version or a 45 version of the song. Just you pick it.
Which one?
We can't tell you what it is, but you got to pick original or 45.
45.
In the key of C, boys.
Way before you tell me things I know that I've heard somewhere. You're standing in the places and you're staring down through faces that bring to mind traces of a girl that I knew some.
In the back anymore.
You want to say something? Yes!
Ah!
We got one more.
One more number. Okay, well, we'll make it a rocker then.
We did that one!
Alright, everybody.
All them high fashion magazines, the
clothes you're wearing, girl, are causing public scenes. I said,
I'm not your stepping stone.
Go, girl.
I'm not your stepping stone.
Stepping stone. I'm not your stepping stone. But you won't find my name in your book of who's who's at it.
I'm not your stepping stone.
Oh, girl, not me.
No. I'm not your stepping stone.
Oh, no. Not your stepping stone.
You when we need you. We'll be here. We've got your number on file. All right. Wonderful. All right, I hope everybody's enjoying themselves at the Davy Jones Memorial we're having here today. I want to call up Lisa Russell Hazen, who's going to read a letter that Davy's daughter Annabelle had posted, and I'm sure many of you have seen it. But for those of you who haven't, she's going to read it for you. First.
My brain is down a little. It's because I'm short, I know. Hello, everyone. I'm honored to be reading this statement because I'm sure that this would be a very touching thing for them to see. I'm touched just by seeing how many people are here, and I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy to read this statement. This is from Jessica and Annabelle. Some of you may or may not know that on Wednesday last week, I lost my father. My family and I have been overwhelmed by the love and support of everyone who has reached out to tell us that we're not alone. Thank you for helping to make me feel less lost and bottomless. Knowing you are all dotted around the earth makes life less frightening. And like if we reached out, we could hold hands and make a chain all the way around the planet. Dad and I connected mostly over music, songwriting, and performance. That's where we understood each other. The hours I spent sitting amongst you all watching him perform are honestly some of my most precious and treasured moments. Everything was so simple while he was up there. I felt proud and close, and I understood him there, as I know you all did.
Hello.
I have heard about Occupy Beavertown. And I want you to know that I think it's a wonderful idea. I wish us girls could be there for you, or with you. It will be so great for you all to be together and see the church that he built for all of us. Please respect the neighbors and your surroundings. I know that you will. Take pictures and send them to me. And keep in touch. Annabelle, XOXO.
Thank you. And once again, the mayor, Bill Wagner.
Thank you very much, Michael. I'll just call you Mike.
Sure.
We're friends. Ladies and gentlemen, the Rescue Hose Company and Beavertown Borough have accumulated some expenses connected with this particular event. We're, I think, about $1,200 short of meeting our expenses. So at this time, we're going to have some ushers come through passing cans. And if you want to make a donation, we'd certainly appreciate it very, very much. So ushers, you can begin your task. And by the way, I'm very ill. I shouldn't be here, but I am. Right now, I would like to bring up to share with you some of the great memories that he had interacting with Davy. My friend, Mr. Bruce Hassinger. Bruce, would you? Bandstand Bruce. He's quite an entertainer himself.
Wow, I was scheduled for 2:30. I showed up a little early and I'm on. It's good to see a nice crowd. What do you think? It's a beautiful day today, huh?
Yeah.
It could be pouring down rain. You know, we could have snow in March. But this is a beautiful day. And I'm going to talk a little bit about Davy Jones. Davy Jones and I, of course, you know he lived right up here. And he and I struck it off right off the bat because I was in the DJ business for 30-some years. And, of course, I'm a connoisseur of music. I have a lot of his memorabilia. And I helped him an awful lot getting started here in Beavertown. There's some neat things that happened between him and I. I'm going to talk a little bit about it. I also own the garage in Beaver Springs, and that's the way we actually started, him and I, as a business relationship. He had some caretakers over here. When he was away, he needed some gasoline, so he'd come up and they charged gasoline. Well, when he'd come home, I always had a bill for him, and he always paid it, so it was no problem. So I would run down to his house, talk to him a little bit, say, Davy, got a bill here for $25. Lawnmower was out. We had to go fix the lawnmower. We had to fix the tractor a couple of times. And then one time he even said, he called me and he says, Bruce, I got a problem. I'm doing a big job up in Williamsport. And they're giving me furniture and I have no way to get home. I said, that's no problem. You can use my truck. So he truly traded car for truck for the day. And of course, about 3:30 in the afternoon, he said, hey, I did all that advertising and everything up there for Williamsport for the radio station. Really neat, huh? I said, yeah. He says, come on down. You got to help me unload furniture. So I drove his car down to the place here, and we traded car for the truck, but I had to carry all the furniture in for him. So, and it was never always something to do with Davy around. He'd call me, and who knows? One time he called me at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And he said, I'm playing in Hershey tonight. He said, Paul Revere and the Raiders are there. Let me see. Gary Puckett was there. And I'm the last act. I said, our band is done, and they're flying from Harrisburg. They're going back to, some of them are Colorado. Two of them, I think, were Canada. He said, I don't have a way home. He said, how about seats in the second row? And then you just stay there afterwards. You can bring me along home. I said, no problem. We can do that. So I ran down to Hershey, and I had nice seats, you know, sitting in the second row. And, of course, nobody knew who I was, so it didn't matter. But then he jumped in the car, and I brought him home. Well, it was nice talking to him, where all he was, and so forth and so on. Now, one of the vehicles that he had that was up here that didn't work very darn good was a gray van. And I believe I worked on that thing day in and day out for about a month to finally get it running. And he had a concert in the fall of the year over at the Bloomsburg Fair. And I just happened to have tickets for that too. So I ran over to the Bloomsburg Fair to see. Now that was with the whole Monkees. Now I had the opportunity to see the Monkees with all four of them. I had the opportunity to see the Monkees with three of the four, and I had the opportunity to see Davy Jones six different times. So, being I was Bandstand Bruce, I had those opportunities. And the funny thing of that was, I went walking into the Bloomsburg Fair, here comes the gray van. People are clapping and hollering, who the heck is that in that old gray van? Well, I didn't tell them because I knew whose it was because I worked on the blooming thing for a month before that just to get it to run. But anyhow, that was Davy Jones in there in this old beat-up van going into the Bloomsburg Fair to sing. And, of course, we had tickets and we went down. And I went down there and the people at the bank over here, they had free tickets too and they had backstage passes and so forth. So everybody around town here got to see Davy Jones at the Bloomsburg Fair with the Monkees at that time. Now, the biggest concert that was ever put on at the Beaver Springs Fireman's Carnival was Davy Jones. How many people, by show of hands, were at that concert? Quite a few. That was the biggest Saturday night we've ever had. I produced that, by the way. And that was in the year 2000. So that was 12 years ago. Davy still remembers it. Now, some people said that he had to do that because there was a DUI charge. Wrong. I was also the treasurer of the fire company at the time. I can tell you, he did not do that for free. I'm not going to tell you what he got, but we did pay him for that. He was very, very lenient on the price because two of the people were from California, came in, stayed in his house. We didn't have to pay motel rooms. Pretty neat, huh? The only problem was Saturday afternoon they decided they wanted a special keyboard with instrumental stuff in where you could stick the digital stuff in. We didn't have one of them. So we ended up driving to Harrisburg that afternoon to get one of those keyboards and get it up on the stage, and we got it done. So that was a huge concert. Six different vendors came to me that afternoon and said, it rained three nights this week. And you pulled it off, the biggest crowd that has ever been on that area. So for you people who had your hands up there, my hat's off to you because you made it work for those people up there. Give yourselves a round of applause on that one. Now, one of the funniest things that I ever did, and some of this is going to go right over you people's head, but if you are a classic musician and you know, these guys that we're playing are going to know exactly what I'm talking about. There are people here that know what I'm going to talk about. Some of you, it's going to go right over your head. When I was in grade school, I went to grade school up to grade 6. We didn't have middle school. We didn't even have kindergarten. I missed that, too. Anyhow, we had, from 6th grade, you had to go to 7th grade. I know a lot of people didn't do that. They went to middle school, but we didn't. We went right to high school. Now, that is a huge time in your life, because now you're a 6th grader, you're one of the big boys, right? Going to 7th grade, you're a little kid. That's a problem. Well, about August, they send out what your home room is. And guess what my home room was? 7A.
What number is this?
That's right. Jim, what number is 7A. Now, if you people who don't know what that is, talk to the person next to you. They should know. So I got a chance to work at the house also because my daughter was in college up at Williamsport driving back and forth, and all of a sudden he didn't have a caretaker. So my daughter needed some extra money, so guess what? She took care of the horses, took care of the animals, I took care of the phone calls. Now to make a long story short, every now and then I would get a pretty good phone call that I had to pick up and give him a phone call and say, hey, Davy, I don't know what's going on in this. And this was only one winter that I did this because we were friends. And during that time, something unique happened because, like I said, I own a garage up here. I had a tractor trailer stop in, and the tractor trailer driver said, boy, I got a trip here in front of me. He said, I'm leaving Sealands Grove tomorrow with a tractor trailer, going to California. I said, you're going to California? Yep, taking personal belongings all the way to California. And he said, I got a deadhead back. Now, how many people know what deadhead is? That means you're coming back empty. Oh, I said, no kidding. You aren't going to believe this. I said, I got a part-time job for Davy Jones, and out there in cold storage, he has a sign that is the length of this stage that says monkeys on. One in existence. The only one in existence. It's the last time that they played in the 70s as the Monkees got there. He bought it, and it's in cold storage out there. Let me call him. I called him. He's in Nashville on a Friday afternoon. I said, Davy, we got a little problem. What? I said, actually, this guy is going to be in California, 60 miles from where you have that sign, and he's got to come back with nothing on. No kidding. He said, how much does he want? I said, I don't know. You talk to him. So I handed him my cell phone, and Davy talked to him. He says, pay him a couple $100. He's picking up my sign. You'll have it in about 2 weeks. So when you people get a chance to go into the museum, it's there.
Wow.
It's undercover, but it's huge. It's a huge monkey sign. And I helped to make the arrangements to get that there. So I was really impressed with that. And Davy had never forgot that. Now, the one thing that Davy and I really, really had in common was the love of animals. So one day he brings his two daughters from California to my house. And he says, hey, Bruce, we got a little problem up here with mice. In the barn, they're eating. When you go to pick up a bale, you know, you pick it up by those cords. Well, you didn't anymore because the bales were busted off. The mice ate all the cords off. So now we have hay laying all over the place. Major problem. I said, well, you know, if you got a couple cats, we could probably handle that problem. And I said, my mama cat just had a litter. So he brought his daughters up, and they got to pick the pick of the litter. The only problem is, like a dummy, she chose mama cat. Who was really fertile and had about three more litters since he had her. But every time I saw Davy, he would point to me and say, this is my wife, and this is the guy that gave me mama cat. Because he had a lot of cats then, and the caretakers can tell you that they were feeding cats right along, and mama cat pretty well got into the house, and you know, it was a house cat at the end, but just sort of laid around and so forth. But that was really, really good. How many people remember that concert? What year that concert was? Does anybody remember that? In Beaver Springs, the concert.
It was 2000.
2000 is correct. The year 2000, 12 years ago. It was in June of 2000. Just thought I'd ask that question. Now, one of the funniest things that I ever saw in Davy's house, and these other caretakers can tell you this too, is when you would take a note, you know, you get, everybody has little notepads, and they have these little post-its. Davy had those too. So when I get a phone call, I would put it out. And what do you think it said on those post-its? They made a monkey out of me. He had that on all his little post-its, had them printed up specially just for him. Of course, they did make a monkey out of him, but that's the way it went. But Davy had a great sense of humor. I'm just about ready to close. Is that good enough? Okay, I got a lot more I can talk about, but we'll give you one more tidbit of information. You know, Davy had a great sense of humor. A lot of times we'd sit up there and he'd be writing a new song or something, just sitting and playing the guitar or whatever, and one thing that I want to say about Davy is he and I would joke around a lot, and we didn't talk an awful lot about the monkeys because we talked about what was going on in the farm, a personal relationship, so that he could be in this area and didn't have to be worried. When he came in for gasoline at my place, or came in for a loaf of bread, or came in for cigarettes or whatever, he got them and left. I didn't tell everybody who he was so that he didn't spend 25 minutes standing there talking to people, because he enjoyed just going and getting something the way you and I do. Go get a loaf of bread and spend 2 hours getting a loaf of bread? Not fun. So you want to go get gas and you spend 15, 20 minutes signing autographs? Probably not fun. So I left him come and go as he could. But I will tell you one thing. Now that he's gone and we can't talk to him anymore, I'm a real bereaver.
All right, next up, Rocky D'Amelio. He's gonna share his memories of Davy Jones.
Hello, everybody. It's a sad but a happy moment. You know my name. I spent several years with Davy up here. Behind every big person or big pillar in the community, there's very small pillars holding them up. I'm one of them, Bruce. All you people out there are these little pillars, because a performer can't perform really well unless he has an excellent audience. And you guys have been his audience for a long, long time. He loved and respected everybody around here. I met Davy in 97. He had a 3-hour job in the barn that Bruce was talking about. I fixed that electrical problem. Took me 3 hours. And he said, I have another small job for you. Will you walk in my house with me? I'll show it to you. So he took me clean through this house. And it's huge. And I said, Davy, you showed me your house, but you didn't tell me the job. He said, you think you could rewire the whole thing? Wow. So I did. And I'm thinking the job's over, but it really wasn't. About 8 years later, we're still working on it. And I have traveled up and down the East Coast. I was his personal organizer. When he was on the road, I took care of those cats that Bruce so lovingly gave to him. Davy was the type of guy that he fondled things that he loved, and he would always pick those cats up, Bruce. And he would rub them like this and hug them. And then 2 days later, I'm rubbing calamine lotion all over him. So these are the things that go on, like they said, behind the scenes. As far as Beavertown, why he picked Beavertown, this property reminded him of his own home in England. And once he settled down here, he really liked it. He said, you know, this is the part of life that guys like me don't get to share. And that's why he liked this little town. As far as the community, it's like a wheel, okay? A wheel can't run true without all the parts. Now, he left his mark all over the world, but he left a permanent one here. Because when we would be out on the road, or if I'd be up at the house and he'd call me and say, Rocky, can you come and get me? I want to come home. I did not take him to California. I did not take him to Florida. I brought him here to Beavertown. This is his home. This is what he considered his home. Okay? As far as the church goes, there was three of us sitting in a room one day, and Davy said, I have this opportunity to buy this church down the road. So he called a guy in, a friend of his from New York, to look at it, and he was iffy. Davy really wanted it. We're sitting at his dining room table, and he says to me, before we stand up, we're either going to own that church or not. So those two, one nay, one yes. Davy puts his face up against mine, nose to nose, and he says, well, Rocky, are you going to help me fix it up or not? Immediately, the hand went up. Okay, so we got this here problem now. He left you guys. This not just the town, the whole community, the whole state. He left this here little thing here called the museum. So this is the hub of that wheel I'm talking about. And with every wheel you need spokes, you need a rim, you need a tire, and you need somebody to true that wheel up. I consider that church the hub. The community and everybody that loved him, all the people he loved, they're the ones that need to pick up that wheel, add a spoke, somebody true it up, somebody else find a tire, make his dream come true. I know all of his wishes. I did not write any of the stuff down, my fond memories, because I would have to be here next leap year telling you all these things. And nobody really has that time. We're all important. He always told me, we all have our place to fit in. Don't try to be somebody else. Be yourself, and you will find that spot. And that's what I live by to this day. He's the type of guy that would give you the coat off his back. This one was his very favorite coat. He gave me several of those coats. And I said, I don't want to take your coat, Dave. He says, but I really want you to have it, Rocky. Take it, take it. So I accepted his coat. And he says, hope you have a lint brush. I can't go nowhere without lint brushing this coat, but I'm honored to do it, and this will be the last time people will see this coat. Many of you that did see him in public, you'll know he wore it quite often. But he's the type of guy that'll go to a school, not on TV for Marsha Brady, but a regular school for regular people, like my daughter Heidi and my daughter Caitlin, who sang you that wonderful song. He's here in our hearts, and he'll be there forever. He may be gone, but his memories are here. Whenever you want to hear him or see him, we're fortunate. You click that button, CD, DVD, whatever, computer, and he is there, you know. So, and like Davy, he's always somebody to do something off the wall. Now listen, we can listen to his music every day, and we can see him whenever we want, but we only have to celebrate his death every 4 years. What a guy. What a guy. And leave it up to all irony, we're celebrating him today. It's also my deceased mother's birthday. So he made it everything very easy for me to remember. Because as we get older, you seem to forget. And before I forget, I want to thank you, and some of you heard this before, on the behalf of Davy Jones himself and his four daughters, all girls. You had to hear that one before. But don't let his dream die. Don't let your dream die. I'm here. The mayor can get a hold of me anytime. I'm willing to help out any way I can to see it go through. It might not be what he expected and wanted to do himself, because I can tell you what he wanted to do. He shared this with me a lot of times, over and over and over. But we sure can make it a museum and make it live, and it'll keep Beavertown on the map. He's already put it here. Let's just keep it here. He's given this town a gift. That's his way of doing things. And I just hope he rests in peace. His music and his love will be in my heart forever. And we will be again someday, brother. And I just hope you all feel the same way about each other. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rocky. All right, this time we're going to share a couple of special messages from Davy's very special friends. And my friend Bill Piccirillo is going to help me with this.
No, I'm.
And we're going to read these to you.
Good afternoon, y'all. Appreciate you coming out today. I'm still amazed. I think me and Mike talked about this about a week ago. I knew it was a tough thing for him. I mean, probably the biggest Monkees and Davy Jones fan I've ever met in my life. I met Davy, I was about 13 years old, I think it was. We did a concert in Altoona. And the guy was just, I mean, he was bigger than life for a guy that was 5'3". He was just amazing. And at the time, I worked in the broadcast business, and I thought, you know, this guy's just being nice to me because, you know, my dad was the one who was putting on the show, and, you know, he's signing his check, so he's got to be nice to me. And I just looked around at how he treated everybody, and he treated everybody the same. I mean, he just loved what he did for a living. And it wasn't a job. It was just something that he just loved to do every day. And I think at all the people we saw that worked in the showbiz bands, he was probably the hardest working guy in show business. I mean, he was just everywhere. And I mean, I don't know how many shows that Mike saw him at, but it was just, I mean, the guy was just constant. You know, he was amazing. And I don't even know how I got chosen for this. This is amazing to me. There was a lot of people who couldn't make it today. Amazing to me how many people came in from Juliet, Illinois, Fort Wayne, Indiana. I mean, it's just amazing. And the fact that your mayor, you know, a population of 900 in this town, one mayor and one guy that worked in the radio business got everybody to show up for this. I mean, it's amazing. And we appreciate the hospitality of the mayor and of Beavertown. It's just amazing how hospitable you guys have been to us. So we really appreciate you giving us the opportunity to put this on today.
Definitely.
But we got two special letters from two special people in Davy's life. I think these guys probably spent more time with him than anybody. And in my hand, I have a letter from Peter Tork. Of course, a member of the Monkees who unfortunately couldn't be here today. And Mike also has one. I don't know, you want me to do mine first?
Go ahead.
Okay. For Peter Tork, he writes, "Thank you for the opportunity to contribute some memories at this memorial for David Thomas Jones. I'm truly at a loss for words, mostly remembering moments that pale in the telling of them. I carry so many images of Davy through the years, the bright teen at the center of the Monkees TV show, the witty prankster, always a joke, not always a new joke, but always a joke. The dedicated horseman, the devoted family man, the gifted performer who captured the hearts around the world. Davy adored performing and adored meeting and greeting his fans. He was tireless in making himself available to sing a song, do a dance, shake a hand, whatever was asked of him. I had a heart-to-heart moment with Davy, and they were among the best in my life. I was blessed to know and work closely with him. He was one in about 6 billion, give or take. We won't see his like again. He left much too soon. I share your sadness. Thank you again for this chance to contribute. God bless and keep you all." And that's from Peter Tork. I believe that copy of these are going to be available. You're going to provide them to the mayor.
Well, we'll put them on Facebook.
Be on Facebook. So if you guys want to check them out for yourself.
At some point.
And Mike has another pretty amazing message from somebody else he'd like to share with you.
Now, this is from another guy. Perhaps you heard of him, Mickey Dolenz. He writes, "I never thought in a million years that I'd be writing something like this. Where do I start? How do I finish? How can I possibly describe in a few words me and Davy Jones? We worked together, we lived together, we had families together, we played and fought together like best friends in a schoolyard. We were as close to siblings as you could possibly get. He was my brother. One day many years ago, when we were on a concert tour of England, we rolled into town and Davy asked if I wanted to go out on the track and exercise a racehorse. Being a horseman myself, I jumped at the opportunity. We mounted the horses and took off. Within seconds, we were going 1,000 miles an hour. As we rode neck and neck, flying like the wind, we looked over at each other and laughed hysterically, like two little kids on their first hobby horses. I have seldom felt such a thrill. Ride on, cowboy. Ride on."
Wow.
I think I'm going to read my letter now, and I can't stand, so I'm going to have to move the chair over here. How many of you are familiar with the name of Alan Green?
Yeah.
Alan and I were very close friends, very, very close. And he said that there was one thing held him up from coming in, but he wrote a letter to me to read to you folks, and that's what I'm going to do now. "Dear Bill, I'm so sorry I couldn't make it, but please know I'm with you in spirit and send my thoughts and prayers to you all. How can I possibly convey all the intense feelings that have accompanied the sad news of this last 7 to 10 days? I'm sure we're all going through the same blur of emotions, and I'll bet most of you gathered here today are remembering David by recounting your personal memories, either of meeting him or of meeting each other through Monkey's connections that have resulted in lifetime friendships. So even at this time of great sadness and grief, David is again bringing us together, and it behooves us to rejoice in his freedom and not be downcast by our own feelings of loss. He'd be the first to tell you that out of the grief comes something good, always good grief. As a prime example, I think I should reveal something that most of you do not know concerning Beavertown. It was only as a result of a devastating, terrible event in my life that the whole Davy Jones and Beavertown saga came into being. Good things do come from bad, always. You just have to look relentlessly for the good. I think you all know how much your special little community has been a large part of both David's and my life. For myself, it was my home from late 1983 to early 1993. My beautiful daughter, Alana, was born in the old Kearns house on the main road through town on August the 28th, 1984. I remember climbing onto the roof and painting "It's a Girl" on the chimney the morning after her birth so the whole town would know that our long overdue angel had arrived safely at last. Mary Ann, and that's Mary Ann Zechman. Are you here, Mary Ann? Okay. Mary Ann, our next door neighbor, was a constant help with everything imaginable that happens when a baby arrives, and believe me, everything imaginable and unimaginable did happen. And it was because of the unimaginable breakup of my marriage less than a year later that I became a permanent resident of Beavertown for the next decade, just so that I could remain close to my daughter in Harrisburg. Had that breakup not occurred, Alana's mother and I had planned on returning to Hollywood, where I had only temporarily abandoned my recording career. I had a hit record there on CBS Pasha label, I Surrender, in 1981-82. Also, of course, Los Angeles was the center of David's recording and entertainment activities, and the plan was always to return there as soon as our daughter was ready for school. When the breakup happened, all those plans went out the window. So I often look back and say, were it not for the awful breakup, I never would have had an incredibly wonderful 10 years in Beavertown, and Davy Jones never would have found his favorite home. I'm sure at least one of you in the gathering must have a copy of They Made a Monkey Out of Me. Handy? Yes. Well, pause for a moment and read the second page of Alan's intro. It's on page 4 of the first edition copy, on page 7 of the second edition. Start at, I bring Davy to my home one day, the streaming metropolis of Beavertown, PA, population about 12. He says, sorry, poetic license. That story, the turning of Wendy Clark's grief into pure magic, says it all, doesn't it? That would never have happened had my marriage lasted. We'd all have been back in the steamier metropolis of Hollywood, and Beavertown, PA would have kept its nice, quiet reputation. Now, Mayor Bill Wagner may have his own views of whether that would have been a preferable scenario or not, smile. That's just in parentheses, smile. But the bottom line is David loved his Beavertown, and so did I, and neither of us would have changed the story even to have saved us grief. Beavertown, as it turned out, was a perfect hideaway for David, where he could retreat to nature with his horses and plan his next exploration out into the world in relative peace and quiet. And the same was true for me. I finished a musical and did some of my best songwriting there. And of course, brought up my wonderful daughter as best I could under the circumstances. It was a blessed haven, and I will always cherish its memories. One that comes to mind is typical David through and through. Of all the things that marked him as a great artist, one of my favorite stories to tell is of sitting at David's kitchen table one day when a fan arrived at the door completely unannounced. Now, most famous people that I've known, I have to say, are very protective and are of their privacy. And I think we all can understand why. They live a life exposed to the public who in turn sometimes feel they are owed access. It's an attitude of, well, without me supporting you, you'd be nothing, so you should give me time when I take the trouble to show up. And that may be true at a concert. And, as you know, all know, David was always the last to leave after a show. If there was one more book or album or program to sign, he'd be there signing it. But showing up at your kitchen door, that's another matter. There are many crazies out there. There are many crazies out there. Just because someone's a celebrity, it doesn't mean you can cross their very personal line of their private home. But I have to tell you, David never minded. I saw him welcome that fan in, sit them down, put on a kettle, have a cup of tea, and most astounding of all, play a song he had just written on a guitar. And the thing I noticed was that magic in performance. It came through just the same as if he were playing in front of 20,000 screaming fans at a stadium. Just one-on-one in the kitchen, his performance was exactly the same. He poured his heart and soul into that song just for that one stranger. Pure magic, that, my friends, is one of the things I love most about David Jones. That and the fact that he was, without fear of exaggeration, the funniest man I've ever known. He could make you laugh until it hurt. In fact, he loved to do just that. That's how "They Made a Monkey Out of Me" came into being. David and I would tell stories. I'd laugh until I was in agony. And somewhere within that process, I'd be writing down a recording on a handy little mini tape recorder later. Eventually, after 7 years in the making, I managed to edit it all together in voila, a book, created entirely on the Macintosh and, most importantly, created entirely in Beavertown. One last thing. As some of you might know, I do now live in Los Angeles, have for the last 12 years or so. I attend the same church that the monkey songwriter Bobby Hart goes to. It's a church that puts a lot of emphasis on spiritual techniques and meditation. I've practiced these techniques for over 30 years, and in fact, when I first became David's musical director, it was a constant source of fun between David and me. At night after the gig, whenever the band was going off to party, I'd go to my bedroom or hotel room and meditate. Now, you all know the classic pose of meditation. You sit down, you look upwards with arms outstretched and palms upraised. David used to imitate this position and say, "Why me, Lord? Why me?" As though his upturned hands were a plea to heaven. Why me? It was very funny, and it became a standing joke between us for years on the road. There'd be parties going on. He'd come to my room and say, "Are you going to party with us, or are you going to why me it tonight?" And yes, you guessed it, my answer was almost always, "Nah, I think I'm going to why me it." It was all good-natured fun, but David was always very curious about it and would ask me what the appeal was. "Hey man, what happens when you why me it? How can you that be better than partying?" And I always would say something. Like, "Well, I'm not against partying, but meditation helps you and it makes you feel a certain peacefulness. Maybe you should try it. You might like it." And he'd always say, "You must be joking, man," or some such lighthearted response as that. But I knew he was curious. He lived a very turbulent life and craved the sort of peace of mind that meditation can bring if you practice it regularly and devotedly. Anyway, the point of the story is one day on the road in the middle of a long, grueling tour schedule, I happened to walk into the backstage dressing room earlier than expected and switched on the light, and there was David sitting in a chair with his palms upturned. I only saw it for a split second because as soon as the light went on, he jumped up startled and started rearranging things on the dresser. Clearly taken by surprise, I said, "Aha, gotcha, you were why me-ing it." Of course, he denied it vehemently. He stammered out something about taking a nap, and that was that. He never admitted it. He never asked me about it again. But I have a message from the Manchester Cowboy today. No, but I have a message for the Manchester Cowboy today in front of all these people who love you dearly and remember you fondly and miss you terribly. My dear friend David, I know you were wanting some of that peace that the world never seemed ready to give you. And I'm pretty sure you must have tried on more than one occasion to why me it. But you were a proud, proud man and couldn't ask for it outright. Well, David, I'm absolutely sure where you are now, they're why me-ing it up a storm. And I really feel that you need to, and I know you'll feel no need to hide it there. So go ahead, do both, party and why me it. You deserve it, and by the way, not planning on moving in anytime soon, but hey, save me a seat. Your friend always, Alan Green. Thank you so very much. I just wish I would, I'm normally a strong strong guy, but something just hit me a couple of days ago and it's really bad, so I wish I could have read it with the zest and the gusto that I usually have.
You did a great job. Give him a hand.
I have the privilege of sharing some words from David Alexander. He was the keyboard player, is the keyboard player for currently the Mickey Dolenz band, toured with the Monkees. You might remember him as being the one that did the Edith and with Archie and Archie skit with San Gennaro. David writes, "Dear friends, thank you so much for giving me the honor and the opportunity to be with you all today. Although I cannot be there personally, I am with all of you in heart and spirit, and I share deeply in everybody's grief. I can hear my friend Davy telling me as clear as day, the show must go on, man. By getting to know the real Davy Jones, I ended up finding out that even though he was quote-unquote just a regular guy, he was so much more. He possessed a golden heart, a magical touch and intuition that brought so many good people together. Friendships that I have made through him that have lasted as long as I've known Davy. When I first arrived in Beavertown, trying to keep my cool, he showed me around to his favorite places, introduced me to people he knew in the community, made me feel so comfortable and part of everything. I was just amazed and so happy. I truly felt that this is where Davy was most comfortable and at home. No pressures, just him, his horses, and his family and friends. Chopping wood for the fireplace, mucking out the horse stables, helping with the yard, or cooking the big meal for everybody, it was the perfect getaway, a home away from home. I often wonder if he loved it here so much because Pennsylvania resembles a huge version of the English countryside. I am there right now thinking about all the beautiful and wonderful opportunities I've been blessed with thanks to David Thomas Jones. Thank you, Beavertown, for being David's home away from home. We will all love him forever. David Alexander."
Thank you. All right, now we're moving a little bit behind as far as what we wanted to do, so we're going to miss some of the things that we wanted to do. But what we really want to do is we want to have a vigil to the church museum theater that Davy had planned downtown. So if anybody has things that they would like to leave at the church, you can line up first. And people within that has come a long way can also line up. And what we're going to do is we're going to go down, and groups of us are going to be allowed across the street, 522, where you can leave your memorial on the steps of the church, and then you will come out around and come back to here, and then we'll wrap it up. So but everybody that wants to do this can start lining up in here, and we'll get you taken care of. And if you guys want to play a few tunes, sounds good.